Scotland, in the north of the United Kingdom, a fascinating and atmospheric land. A land of Celtic myths and legends, with green hills, barren highlands, mysterious lakes, and mighty castles. In the center of the capital, the impressive Edinburgh Castle crowns the hard basalt cone of an extinct volcano, the historic heart of the nation. This, Scotland's most well-known castle, is still guarded by soldiers, and now it's only tourists who storm the defiant rock. In the 7th century, the Northumbrian King Edwin had a fortress built here, the Castle on the Hill, Edinburgh. In the 15th century, the Royal Palace was built on the area's highest plot of land. This is where Scotland's crown jewels are kept. The Royal Mile leads downhill from the castle, a long street, with several adjoining streets. There are many small museums to be found here, while a disguised freedom fighter and proud war veterans accompany tourists on their way to the valley below. St. Giles Cathedral is closely related to Scottish history. It's one of the main churches of Presbyterianism and is named after the patron of the city. St. Giles is the place of the Reformation, where the Church of Scotland begins. Just off the upper section of the Royal Mile is a church and Greyfriars cemetery with its many historic tombs. Greyfriars Bobby attained much celebrity, a loyal Skye terrier who, following the funeral of his master, guarded his grave for 14 years before he too finally passed away. The Royal Mile continues. Edinburgh's historic tourist route and also its oldest street. Next, the former home of reformer John Knox, who led debates on questions of faith with Mary, Queen of Scots. The street ends at the Palace of Holyrood House, the official Scottish residence of the British Queen. This is Holyrood Park. Since the 12th century, royal hunts have taken place here. Today it's used for recreation and covers 270 acres. Just behind it, a little lake, St. Margaret's Loch. Then down to Duddingston in a protected nature reserve. Duddingston is a dreamy village. But back to Edinburgh. In the valley between the Castle Mountain and the new town, there was once a small lake which became a cloaca. Where once the Norhall, a cesspit, stank, a park was built in 1876. An artificial hill with museums named the Mound separates the western and eastern sections of the gardens. Next, East Prince's Street Gardens. A green paradise with huge trees, well-maintained lawns, and the Sir Walter Scott Monument. At the end of Prince's Street is the Balmoral Hotel. Directly beyond is Calton Hill. This city of poets and culture is one of the oldest urban residences in Europe. Close to Edinburgh, Culross is located on the River Forth. an inhabited museum village that recalls a famous past. With original buildings from the 16th and 17th centuries. On a hill beyond the village is an abbey that was founded by Cistercians in 1217. In 1642, part of it was transformed into a mausoleum for the Bruce family. Prosperity resulted from coal mining and trade. The palace is actually an historic manor house, former residence of important merchant Sir George Bruce. Its furnishings were of the finest 16th and 17th century designs. The hillside behind the palace contains a romantic garden. In front of the nearby Ochil Hills and situated on a hill with splendid views are the imposing ruins of Castle Campbell. It was built by the Earl of Argyll in the 15th century. He was head of the Campbell clan, who played a leading role in Scotland's history. In 1650, Oliver Cromwell's forces destroyed the castle, and the clan moved to Stirling. Today, nature hides all traces of the battle. The beauty of the dense forests and hills of the Trossachs was made famous by author Sir Walter Scott in the 19th century. This, the most scenic region in central Scotland, possesses grandiose, wild and romantic natural scenery. The remote Loch Katrine attracts many visitors, and it brings to mind Sir Walter Scott's poem, The Lady of the Lake. Certain parts of the descriptive text seem to leap out from the loch. This is also the land of Rob Roy, the Scottish Robin Hood. Gregor Roy, the head of the MacGregor clan, became an outlaw. He was forced to hide from his enemies after everything was taken from him, mainly by the Duke of Montrose. Trossachs means hard, rugged country. And until the early 19th century, the region was almost inaccessible. The MacGregor clan reigned in its remote and densely wooded valleys and canyons and knew well how to defend it. It's mostly sheep that populate the landscape, and the spinning of wool is an age-old tradition here. Tartan is woven on large looms. Traditional checked fabric in the colours of Scotland's natural scenery, which was first mentioned in a document in 1538. Continuing inland, Loch Lomond, surrounded by gentle hills. It's a 36-kilometre-long freshwater lake, which became Scotland's first national park in 2002. The picturesque village of Luss on the west coast has an old church and cemetery. And small stone-built houses with gardens full of colourful flowers and rich vegetation. In recent times, the houses and streets of Luss have become well known as the location of a Scottish television series. Many of its picturesque cottages are rented out in the summer. A charming place, even in the high season when crowds of visitors stroll through its narrow streets and along its lakeland shores. Further towards the west coast is the village of Inverary on the banks of Loch Fyne. It has fine white buildings and its short main street leads from the harbour to the church. The heart of the settlement, with shops and good restaurants. The Georgian court building was also used as a prison. The church was once divided into two sections. One for the Gaelic-speaking residents and one for the English. At the pier, there's an old sailing ship that is now a maritime museum. Inverary Castle is the village's main attraction. It is the residence of the Duke of Argyll. In 1743, Robert Morris had the castle built for the head of the Campbell clan, Archibald Campbell, 3rd Earl of Argyll. At that time, there was nowhere finer in the British Isles. And the clan's ancestors who adorn the walls seem to continue to enjoy the castle's splendor. On display, the family tree, clan pattern, personal items, and family crest. And the great hall has a large collection of weaponry set out in all kinds of fascinating shapes and sizes. The Campbells have a long family history, and they were given the responsibility of tending to the king's land in this region. Even the salon in which guests were accommodated was designed in a surprisingly modern way. The large kitchen in the basement was used until the 1950s. The castle is surrounded by a well-maintained park with gravel paths and colourful flower beds. Close by, near to Loch Fyne, is an interesting museum village that recalls bygone days. The Auchendrayne Old Highlands Township. Once such communities were widespread. In the 18th and 19th centuries, many people left the villages. Sheep farming became popular here. Life was hard, and those who left the area hoped to earn a better living elsewhere. Loch Linnhe is a true legacy of the Scottish Highlands. Around 20 kilometres north is Kilmartin Castle at the end of Loch Linnhe. It's one of the most beautiful ruins on the longest lake in Scotland. In 1450, Sir Colin Campbell had a five-story tower built here. In about 1500, work on an extension began, and up until the 17th century, it was gradually developed into a fortress. In 1760, a fire destroyed a large part of the site. On the Firth of Lorne is Kilmartin Glen, one of the most important prehistoric regions in Scotland. Here, standing stone, 3-metre-high monoliths are scattered across meadows with grazing sheep. The Bronze Age megalithic grave mounds and stone circles can be seen from Duchraigaig Cairn. It's believed that this, the oldest site of the Neolithic period, originated in 3000 BC. At Oban, the west coast, the North Atlantic Ocean. A bustling harbour city that has become a popular holiday resort, the gateway to the Western Isles. Well-kept buildings line the Little Bay, which is what its Gaelic name means. The city's economic success began in the 18th century. Oban became an important transit and collecting point for cattle, which were herded from here to the lowlands and also to England. Above the port area is McCaig's Tower, a perfect replica of the Colosseum in Rome. Wealthy banker John Stuart McCaig planned its construction as an attempt to fight unemployment. Boat excursions go from the harbour, and ferries transport people, goods and animals to the islands of the Inner Hebrides. For more than 200 years, it's been difficult to find accommodation in this very popular small town, as noted by both Theodore Fontaine and Samuel Johnson. In the second half of the 19th century, excursion steamers brought tourists here from Glasgow. A railway line made it even more accessible. the boats leave on time and move slowly out of the harbour, passing the island of Carrera. The view from Pulpit Hill is breathtaking. Many small islands appear, green, uninhabited, as well as a bright white lighthouse. Duart Castle is located on a headland. Soon we reach Crenure, the ferry port of the Isle of Mull, one of the most easily accessed islands of the Great Hebrides. Apart from a guest house, tourist office, and a small chapel, there's not much going on here. Unlike the northern end of the island, the main settlement, Tobermory, a settlement which in the 18th century was built by the British Fisheries Society as a fishing port. Today, the colourful facades of the houses on the lakeside road attract hordes of tourists. And most of the island's inhabitants are employed here. Brightly painted houses are grouped picturesquely around the bay, where in 1588, a galleon of the Spanish Armada, supposedly laden with treasure, went down. Back on the mainland, the route heads along Loch Linnhe northwards. Passing Castle Stalker, which stands in gloomy defiance on a tiny island of the loch, surveying all around. In the early 14th century, the MacDougall clan built a fort here. A castle was subsequently developed by the Stuart clan in the following century. It saw many hostilities, but in the end was won by the Campbells after Duncan Stuart gambled it away. Across the north runs the Great Glen. Loch Linnhe, Lochy and Ness mark its course, which passes through some amazing landscapes. The Valley of Tears provides a glimpse into the past. In 1692, Glen Coe was the scene of a terrible massacre. One reason why the Campbells, or more specifically the clan of the Dukes of Argyll, repeatedly took over the role of villain in the history of Scotland was their loyalty to the English king. William of Orignon married the daughter of the Scottish ruler and also began to reign in the far north. He humbled the Highlanders at every opportunity. Finally, he demanded the loyalty of the clans, and because the MacDonalds took too long to agree, they were murdered in their sleep by the Campbells. From Glen Coe, further inland is the remote Rannoch Moor in the Grampian Mountains, the final major ice field of the last ice age. The cloudy and frequently wet weather in the solitude of the highlands creates splendid moorland scenery. Fort William is a small town on the banks of the long Loch Linnhe. This place has a rich history. It began with the construction of a fort in the 17th century, an outpost of civilization. It was a wild country, and the great fortress of the English government troops controlled access to the Great Glen. Around the garrison of Fort William, a settlement grew. But in 1867, the fort gave way to the construction of a railroad, and instead of a military base, a railway station was built. In Fort William train station, the Jacobite is awaiting its passengers. The huge black monster is an impressive sight, and it's photographed by tourists from all over the world. Slowly, the nostalgic train moves off. The Jacobite begins its journey on one of the most beautiful railway routes in the world. The West Highland Railway is one of the last lines built in Scotland. Suddenly, it emerges from the distance. A bridge that has now made film history due to Harry Potter's magic train, the Hogwarts Express. At a slower pace, our train travels across the Glenfinnan Viaduct. The beautiful landscape charms with each new curve. Bagpipes welcome passengers at the station. A visit to the West Highland Railway Museum that is situated in the small station is an absolute must for any railway enthusiast. A tower, the Glenfinnan Monument, marks a milestone in the Jacobite uprising. The train is calling and it's time to get on board. Then again, it says free ride. A total of 270 kilometers through wild hills, dark moors, and along a rugged coastline. The dramatic interaction of rock and water gives the landscape a dramatic appearance, even in somewhat rare good weather. Rising gradients, the museum railway barely manages 30 miles an hour. But on the flat, the pace increases. Suddenly, from out of nowhere, the first buildings appear. Our final destination, where a young man welcomes us with his bagpipes. Mullag is the economic capital of the fisheries on the west coast of Scotland. In the 1960s, mainly kippers, but today, crabs. In those days, the region's famous smoked kippers were produced, but now there's only a single traditional smokehouse. Tourism is gradually coming here, with accommodation in small hotels and private homes. Several families came to settle here in the 1840s. When the railway and later road traffic reached this distant location, a ferry connection to the offshore islands became necessary. From having been at the end of the world, it became a busy traffic junction and holiday destination. The Highlands are an extremely popular tourist attraction, a sparsely populated landscape. And there's a bagpiper dressed in a kilt who well knows how to play his pipes. Here are isolated lakes, upland moors, and barren areas. A captivating idyll, enchanting and mysterious. Built in the Middle Ages, Aileann Donnan Castle is considered to be the epitome of Scottish romance. Strategically located at the junction of three arms of the sea, it was once the heart of a sea kingdom, and later the seat of the tribal leader of the Macrae clan. Finally, in the 17th and 18th centuries, it was the setting of a dramatic conflict between the Highland clans and the English. The castle was repeatedly destroyed and rebuilt. It was also the location of the Highlander film and a James blockbuster. Almost at the gates of Fort William is the Caledonian Canal, which connects Loch Linnhe in the west with Inverness on the east coast. Neptune's staircase marks the beginning of this grand artificial waterway that leads to Loch Lochy. Covering a distance of only 1.5 kilometres, the boats are raised over 8 congestion levels in order to overcome 20 metres of geological fault. The Caledonian Canal meant that the circumnavigation of the northern tip of Scotland was no longer necessary, so saving time, money, and lives. In Fort Augustus, amateur skippers have to overcome a stairway of 5 locks, which were considered to be a great technical achievement in bygone times. Situated alongside the canal, the Clansman Centre provides a good insight into life in the Highlands. For 19 years, many of the local people were employed in the construction of this waterway that stretches from the Atlantic Ocean to the North Sea. The southern gateway to Loch Ness opens up and represents a free passage on Scotland's most famous loch. Our next adventure begins. Loch Ness extends for 40 kilometres through the valley. The exhibition centre features diving suits and mini submarines that were used in the search for the allegedly much-seen monster of the deep. But each search was in vain. The lake has not yet divulged its secret, because at a depth of 325 metres, anything is possible. Urquhart Castle is situated on a rocky headland on the western shore of Loch Ness, an ideal place for both monsters and ghost stories. The dark ruins survey the mystical lake. In the 12th century, a fort controlled the Great Glen at this strategically important location. King Alexander II transferred rule to the powerful Durwood family following the suppression of a rebellion in Moray. 300 years later, the fort became an unassailable castle, which also served as a residence, administration centre, barracks, court, and prison. In 1692, the mighty bulwark was then partially dismantled in order to prevent it from being taken by the Jacobites. More than 1,500 years of turbulent history is buried under these ruins. The old road and its bridge at Invermorriston have long been the only way across the wild tributaries of the lake. And on the outskirts of Inverness, the capital of the Highlands, the Caledonian Canal comes to an end. 10 kilometres east is the battlefield of Culloden. Flags mark the lines of the English government troops and the Jacobites. The attempt to reinstall the Stuarts to the Scottish throne finally failed here on the 16th of April 1746. The Highlanders were overwhelmingly defeated by the Duke of Cumberland's forces. The battle began at noon and lasted barely an hour. The British artillery fired incessantly and approximately 1,500 Jacobites were killed. In the peaceful Spey Valley is the Highland Folk Museum that depicts the story of life in the Highlands. This historic open-air museum is modelled on a village of the early 17th century, with old stone houses that are covered with reeds and moss. The interior was modest, and its inhabitants led a hard life. It was not only castles and clans that determined Scottish history, but also small tenant farmers, merchants, and craftsmen. There's also a water-powered sawmill that dates back to 1863. The village tailor worked in his small green wooden hut from 1918. And the village school was inaugurated in 1925. There's also an 18th century farm. And a family home with adjoining post office. A herb shop with many products on display. And a fine living room next door. Nearby, in the same valley, is the Highland Wildlife Park. In around 100 hectares of natural landscape are shaggy bison, Highland cattle, deer, horses and sheep. Wildcats, mountain cocks and owls feature among the rare inhabitants of the wildlife park. As well as a comical group of monkeys. The wildlife includes red pandas, wild duck, ibex, and snow owls. And two polar bears who obviously feel at home here. They've all adapted to the wild climate of the Highlands. Bayside is the kingdom of malt whisky. The malt whisky trail leads to a number of distilleries. Here to the village of Tomantoul is a fine distillery. The whisky distilled here is a combination of magic, skill, history, and time. It all begins with the soaking of barley in water that promotes germination. This creates green malt. Germination creates enzymes which convert the starch into fermentable sugar. Barley, yeast and water, these are the traditional ingredients of Scotch whisky. All malt whiskies are produced in a similar way, but environment, maturity and storage, and above all water, have a strong influence on their individual character and flavour. Whisky was first documented in 1494, and Celtic monks referred to it as the water of life. Over the centuries, its ingredients and distilling method have not changed. Each whisky has its own character. In those places where water is transformed into whisky, it seems as though time has stood still. In the small town of Dufftarn, Glenfiddich is thought to be the most visited distillery in Scotland, and the whisky distilled here is a brand leader. This is the only distillery in the Highlands that uses just one source of water and has its own bottling plant. Each day, visitors are guided through the distillery, where its production is explained in detail. But not its secret formula. The history of Glenfarclas is as colourful as the whisky of the same name. It's the story of the Grant family and their distillery. Tours are also popular here. There's an explanation of how the barley grains are sorted and then dried over a peat fire, and how the green malt is mixed in huge vats with hot water and then transformed into a sugar-containing solution. In wooden vats of boiled wash, yeast is added. The mixture is left to bubble for several days. The fermentation process begins. The yeast converts the sugar into alcohol and a clear liquid forms. The liquid is distilled twice in copper distilling tanks, and young whisky is created. Maturation is the final process. For this, the whisky is stored in oak barrels that once contained sherry. The Scottish gold must be stored for at least 3 years until the traditional taste of single malt whisky is produced. However, it can often be left to mature for 12, 15 or even 50 years. Under the stern gaze of the ancestors of the whisky dynasty, and to complete the tour, we're treated to a tasting of the single malt. On our journey through the Highlands to the east, we visit the stone circle of Tom na Veri. Near the Dee River Valley is a picturesque fairy tale castle. Craigivar Castle, the epitome of Scottish baronial architecture. A mixture of medieval castle, tower house, and French Renaissance. Its cornerstone was laid in the 15th century, and in the 17th, the tower house was equipped with battlements, turrets, gables, and oriel windows. When the Mortimers became barons, They wanted to show off their new social standing, and so the castle, both inside and out, was designed accordingly. William Forbes, its subsequent owner, introduced his own style of architecture and interiors in 1610. He had studied at Edinburgh and became a successful merchant who was familiar with Europe and therefore the fashionable designs of the time. Subsequent generations introduced their own ideas and ensured the future of the castle. From the plateau of the tower, the view is particularly beautiful, and its landscape park and green hills frame Craigievar Castle. Further southeast, close to Dundee, is the little village of Glamis, set within a gently undulating landscape. It contains the Angus Folk Museum. In an abandoned terraced settlement of the early 19th century, splendidly decorated rooms highlight the everyday life of the people of that time. From cookware to various furnishings, there are several interesting objects on display. Including toys made of sheet metal, wood, and porcelain in various showcases. The parish church is situated on the edge of the village. And a small river flows in a tranquil hollow near to the church. With highland cattle grazing peacefully around Glamis. Glamis Castle is world famous. Here, the Queen Mother, Queen Elizabeth, and Princess Margaret spent their childhood. And it's where Shakespeare's Macbeth murdered King Duncan. In the large castle park, the Highland Games are held, tribal festivals that have been celebrated for centuries. Physical trials, music, and dance. These include shot put, tug of war, hammer throwing, and probably the most unusual of them all, tossing the caper. The tree trunk must turn a complete somersault. There are pipers' competitions and traditional dances such as the Highland Fling. His lordship and son guard the trophies. An impressive team of bagpipers march in perfect formation while playing stirring, traditional tunes. Our journey ends in the heart of Scotland, where once the Stuarts settled. In Falkland, Falkland Palace. Remarkable tapestries, paintings, and furnishings reveal the French influence that prevailed in the court of James V. Five days after the birth of Mary Stuart, her 30-year-old father, James, died here, in what was thought to be a deep depression. His army had been subjected to a devastating defeat by the English, and his daughter Mary was not able to produce a male heir. In the park is the Royal Tennis Court, the oldest in the world. In northern Britain, both the past and present are closely united, and the Middle Ages are still part of the scenery. Scotland is like a land from an ancient and historic time whose real treasure is its natural, rugged scenery.